Hello students, today I have come up with the next part of the chapter Atomic Structure from class 11 syllabus. So today we will start with Rutherford's scattering experiment. With the help of this experiment, Rutherford was able to derive his own atomic model. So let's start with the experiment. Rutherford's scattering experiment was done in 1911 to depict the atomic model. Now, what did he do? He took a lead block. This is a lead block. He took a lead block and inside it he placed a radioactive isotope. The radioactive isotope that he took is bismuth 214 nucleus. This is a nucleus that he took. Oh, sorry. This will be 83. Bismuth is 83. By mistake, I have written 84, but bismuth is 83. So, the nucleus, the radioactive nucleus or radioactive isotope that he has taken is bismuth 214. Okay, so this acts as a source of alpha particles. From the lead block, inside there is the alpha particle source. From there, alpha particle is emitted. And he has now placed a plate. The plate is made up of lead only. He has placed a lead plate. And inside he has placed a slit. It is a slit inside the lead plate. And later what did he do? From here we have seen that how the alpha particles are emitted. The alpha particles will pass through this slit and then he has placed a thin gold foil. This is a thin gold foil. He has placed a thin gold foil. These alpha particles will pass through this slit and it will get bombarded on this thin gold foil. And around this he had kept a fluorescent screen. How did he make the fluorescent screen? He has coated the entire screen with zinc sulfide. He has coated the entire screen with zinc sulfide. Now, when the alpha particles will strike on this screen, as soon as the alpha particle will strike on this screen, there will be a flash of light shown, which is known as scintillation. So, as soon as the alpha particles are falling on this screen, a flash of light develops, means a lot of scintillations are developed. From the scintillations, they can observe the path of the alpha particles. So, after the experiment, he has certain observations. What did he observe? He observed that there were maximum rays, alpha particle rays, that went undeflected, that passed through the gold foil undeflected. There were certain alpha particles that showed deflection through small angles. And there were a very few alpha particles that showed deflection through angles greater than 90 degree or even 180 degree. So these were the three observations that maximum particles or maximum alpha rays will go undeflected. There were a certain particles that will deflect through small angles. There were a very few particles that will deflect through large angles. These were the observations. Now, these observations have led to certain conclusions. So, what will be the conclusions? He said that atom is maximum having free space. Since atom is having maximum free space, so maximum alpha particles will pass through the gold foil undeflected. No deflection occurs because the atom has free space inside. Okay, now the chances of high deflection or large deflection. Now remember one thing, these are the alpha particles. Now remember one thing that alpha particles are positively charged. So they will get deflected only when they will hit a heavy body that is positively charged. Means this is a positively charged heavy body. The alpha particles will get deflected from this heavy body having positive charge because the alpha particles are themselves positively charged. We know that the like charges repel each other. The alpha particles are positively charged and the heavy body that is fully positively charged, then only the alpha particles will get deflected from the heavy body. So it is said that inside an atom there is a heavy matter portion which is completely positively charged or where the positive charge is completely concentrate, and the deflection through small angles take place for those alpha particles which pass around or which pass close through this heavy positively charged part. That will pass close to this positively charged part. They will get deflected through small angles. And the alpha particles that will hit towards the heavy positively charged part, those will get deflected through large angles. And the particles that will not pass around the positively charged part, those will remain undeflected. Okay? So from there, these are the conclusions which he made. He has concluded this and from there he has made his atomic model. What did he say? He said that atoms contain a positively charged body at the center which is known as nucleus. Then he said that the size of this nucleus is extremely small as compared to the atom. That's why maximum of the atom is free spaced and maximum of the alpha particles will pass undeflected. Otherwise, if this would have constituted the maximum part of the atom, then the maximum rays would have been deflected and not pass undeflected. Since maximum rays are passing undeflected, that means that this heavily positively charged part is a very small part of the atom. Okay. So, it is said that almost the entire part mass of the atom is concentrated at this part. Positive charge is entirely present inside this part. The portion that is outside the nucleus, this portion is known as the extranuclear part. In the extranuclear part, there are imaginary orbits on which the electrons will reside. Okay. So these are the imaginary orbits outside the nucleus on which the electrons will reside, and this is the positively charged nucleus. Okay, so it is said that the electrons, he has said that the electrons remain in the imaginary axis, they will continuously revolve around the nucleus. And why they will remain here? Because we know that normally a moving body has two forces, means a body moving in a circular path experiences two forces. The force towards the center is known as the centripetal force, and the force towards outside is known as the centrifugal force. Since the two forces balance, so the moving object will move continuously in the circular path. This has been known to you from previous knowledge. Now he has said that the electrons will have electrostatic force of attraction with the nucleus, because the electrons are negatively charged and the nucleus is positively charged. And since the electrons are moving, they will experience a centrifugal force outside. Means this is the velocity of, this is the direction of velocity, means this is the direction of revolution of the electrons. This is the electrostatic force, this is the centrifugal force. This will balance each other. Okay. And he has compared his model, he has compared his atomic model with the solar system, saying that the nucleus is just like the sun in the middle, and the planets are just like the electrons which are moving around the sun in fixed paths or orbits. He also said that the atom is electrically neutral only because the total negative charge of all the electrons will balance the total positive charge of the nucleus. This was his atomic model. This was the atomic model which was set forward by Rutherford. Now, Rutherford's atomic model has certain limitations, and these limitations were quite strong limitations. His model, I'll clearly draw the model and explain that. Okay, so this was his model. Center, it will be the nucleus, and in the fixed path or fixed orbit, there will be the electrons. So this was Rutherford's model. There are many fixed paths for the electrons. Now, what we know? We already know that a body which is in circular motion is continuously gaining acceleration, means that is an accelerating body. Means they will not move with a constant velocity. It will be accelerating. There will be acceleration. And we all know that acceleration means when they are continuously gaining the speed, there will be losing of energy. Energy will be emitted. So this also has for, this also means satisfy for the electrons. The electrons are charged bodies and they are continuously moving around the nucleus. So it is said that the charged body moving around the nucleus is also present in an accelerating motion. As a result, it will continuously emit electromagnetic radiation. It will continuously emit electromagnetic radiation. This continuous emission of energy will lead to the decrease in the velocity of the electron. Why? Because the electron is continuously moving and releasing energy, then the energy of the electron is being decreasing. As a result, its velocity will also decrease. So it will happen that the electron will start moving like this, then it will, its velocity will decrease, then its velocity will further decrease, and then its velocity will further decrease, and finally the electron will fall inside the nucleus. This is the negatively charged electron. So when the electron is continuously releasing energy, the velocity of the electron decreases, and it is continuously decreasing. It is continuously decreasing. As the velocity of the electrons are decreasing, the orbits are coming closer to the nucleus, and it will happen that the electron will follow a spiral path and it will fall inside the nucleus. But that is not the fact. Means according to his model, this should happen. According to his model, this should happen. But we know that, but it is seen that the atoms are more than stable. Means the atoms are 100% stable. This does not occur. But if we follow his atomic model, this phenomenon should happen. So his model could not explain this part. Another point is that is the spectra of the atom or atomic spectra. I'll come to atomic spectra in the later part of this chapter only when I'll teach you Bohr's model, means Niels Bohr atomic model. I'll come to that part then. So what is atom? Just remember this point that now the atomic model, the spectra of the atom should be continuous. It is said that the atom should have a continuous spectra that will form a band spectra, continuous means a continuous spectra like this. It should have a band spectra, but it is seen that the atomic spectra is a line spectra. Atomic spectra is discontinuous and it is a line spectra, not a band spectra. This does not occur. Atomic spectra is a discontinuous or line spectra. Okay. Okay. So this is the line spectra, which is the discontinuous line spectra. Okay, so these are basically the limitations of Rutherford's atomic model. And with this, I have completed Rutherford's atomic model. In the next class, we'll start with some isotopes and certain numericals regarding the isotopes. Okay, so thank you.